Up a book and read, open up the cover and read, read all the words inside. Read, travel to a place and read, open up your mind and read, 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 everyone read. Read, pick up a book and read, open up the cover and read, read all the words inside. Read, travel to a place and read, open up your mind and read, 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 everyone read. Okay, this time you have to say read. Here we go. Read, pick up a book and read, open up the cover and read, read all the words inside. Read, travel to a place and read, open up your mind and read, 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 everyone read. Read, 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 everyone read.
I'm Mrs. Bearden. I'm a librarian for St. Tammany Parish Schools. Thanks for joining me today. Today our story is going to be A Fine, Fine School by Sharon Creech. The reading was inspired today by one of the first grade teachers that I work with. Her name is Miss Plaisant. And Miss Plaisant is a wonderful teacher and absolutely loves her first graders. And one day she checked up on them. And after she did, she made a Facebook post that was very moving, and I got permission to share it with you. It says, "Today I checked in with my parents, not to see if they were reading or doing math, just to see how they were holding up, just to get some pictures of my students. It was nothing short of amazing, the things they sent. These kids are fishing, catching alligators, cutting grass, cooking dinner, picking eggs, learning to ride their bikes, losing their teeth, and so much more. One student already has a name for his lawn service. This reminds me of a lesson I taught on A Fine, Fine School. We talked about how school is not the only place you learn lessons. You need so much more than school. The kids and parents are learning together and creating memories." And without further ado, A Fine, Fine School. The book is written by Sharon Creech, and the pictures are by Harry Bliss. Mr. Keene was a principal who loved his school. Every morning he strolled down the hallway and saw the children in their classes. He saw them learning shapes and colors and numbers and letters. He saw them reading and writing and drawing and painting. He saw them making dinosaurs and forts and pyramids. "Oh," he would say, "aren't these fine children? Aren't these fine teachers? Isn't this a fine, fine school?" Near Mr. Keene's school, Tilly lived with her parents and her brother and her dog Beans in a small house next to a big tree. On Mondays and Tuesdays and Wednesdays and Thursdays and Fridays, Tilly went off to school. At school, Tilly learned her shapes and colors and numbers and letters. Sometimes, when she saw Mr. Keene standing in the hallway, he waved. "Aren't these fine children," he said to himself. "Aren't these fine, fine teachers?" Say it with me. "Isn't this a fine, fine school?" On the weekends, Saturday and Sunday, Tilly climbed her favorite tree. You can see up here, there's a speech bubble that says, "I'm stuck, get help." And she took beans on walks and threw him sticks. The speech bubble says, let go now, beans. And she pushed her brother on a swing and tried to teach him how to skip. This speech bubble says, be one with the skip. But on Mondays and Tuesdays, Wednesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays, Tilly went off to school. Beans and her brother did not like to see her go. Hurry, hurry, hurry home, her brother called. One day, Mr. Keene called all the students and teachers together and said, this is such a fine, fine school. I love this school. Let's have more school. From now on, let's have school on Saturdays too. The teachers and the students did not want to go up to school on Saturdays, but no one knew how to tell Mr. Keene that. He was so proud of the children and the teachers, of all the learning they were doing every day. And so that Saturday, Tilly set off to school. But it's Saturday. What about the swings? Her brother called. The following month, Mr. Keene announced, this is such a, ready, fine, fine school. I love this school. Let's have more school. From now on, let's have school on Sundays too. The teachers and the students did not want to go to school on Sundays, but no one knew how to tell Mr. Keene that. He was so proud of the children and the teachers, of all the learning that they were doing every day. And so, that Sunday, Tilly set off for school. But it's Sunday. What about the skipping? Her brother called. The following month, Mr. Keene called everyone together and said, this is such a, you ready? Fine, fine school. I love this school. Let's have more school. From now on, let's have school on holidays too, on Easter and Ramadan and Thanksgiving and Christmas and Hanukkah, on all the holidays on every calendar. I know. I don't think I'd like it either. The teachers and the students did not want to go to school on holidays, but no one knew how to tell Mr. Keene that. He was so proud of the children and the teachers, of all the learning they were doing every day. And so on Christmas, Tilly set off for school. But it's Christmas! What about Christmas? Her brother called. Could you imagine going to school on Christmas? The following month, Mr. Keene called everyone together and said, you ready? This is such a fine, fine school. I love this school. Let's have more school. From now on, let's have school in the summer. All summer long, every day. How much will we learn? He said. We can learn everything. We can learn all about numbers and letters and colors and shapes, the Romans, the Egyptians, and the Greeks. We will learn about dinosaurs and castles and everything. We will learn everything. The teachers and the students did not want to go to school on Saturdays and Sundays and holidays and all summer long, every single day. But no one knew how to tell Mr. Keene that. He was so proud of the children and the teachers, of all the learning they were doing every day. And so, on the first day of summer, Tilly set off for school. But it's summer! What about summer? her brother called. And that day, Tilly went to see Mr. Keene. She stood in his office in front of his desk. You're not going to believe what he said. Yep, you guessed it. What a fine, fine school this is, Mr. Keene said. What amazing things everyone is learning. Yes, Tilly said. We certainly are learning some amazing things. A fine, fine school, Mr. Keene said. But Tilly said, not everyone is learning. What? Mr. Keene said. He looked very worried. Who isn't learning? Tell me, and I will see that they learn. My dog Beans hasn't learned how to sit, Tilly said, and he hasn't learned how to jump over the creek. Oh, Mr. Keene said. And my little brother hasn't learned how to swing or skip. Oh, Mr. Keene said. And I, she said. But you go to school, Mr. Keene said, to our fine, fine school. True, Tilly said, but I haven't learned how to climb very high in my tree, and I haven't learned how to sit in my tree for a whole hour. Oh, Mr. Keene said. That day, Mr. Keene walked up and down the halls, looking at the children and the teachers. Up and down he walked. Up and down. The next morning, Mr. Keene called everyone together. The children and the teachers were very worried. Mr. Keene said, "This is a fine, fine school with fine, fine children and fine, fine teachers. But not everyone is learning." The children and the teachers were very, very worried. Mr. Keene said, there are dogs who need to learn how to sit and how to jump creeks. What did he mean? Was he going to make their dogs come to school? There are little brothers and sisters who need to learn how to swing and how to skip. What did he mean? Was he going to make their younger brothers and sisters come to school too? The children and the teachers were very, very, very worried. And you, all of you children and teachers, you need to learn how to climb a tree and sit in it for an hour, Mr. Keene said. The children and the teachers were very worried. See, they're imagining what it would look like up in the trees down there. The principal saying, 20 minutes to go. See them all in the tree. So here they are at the meeting. And he says, and so from now on, we will not have school on Saturdays or Sundays or holidays or the summer. A huge, enormous, roaring cheer soared up to the ceiling and floated out the window so that everyone in the town could hear the fine, fine children and the fine, fine teacher shout three times, fine, fine, fine. And the fine, fine children and the fine, fine teachers lifted Mr. Keene up, and they carried him down the hallway and out the doors and through the town, up and down, in and out. And everywhere they went, the people said, what a fine, fine school with such fine, fine teachers and fine, fine children and a fine, fine principal. The end. So just like Miss Plaisance said, school is not the only place you learn lessons. You need so much more than school. The kids and parents are learning together and creating memories. And on that note, using a fine, fine school as an example, and Miss Plaisance's Facebook post, I want you to create something. I want you to create a primary source. Now, if you don't know what a primary source is, It's a first-hand account of something that has happened by keeping a diary, a recording, audio recording, or pictures. And so my request for you is to write a list of things that you do when you're not physically in school, but things that you're learning at home, because home is a school zone too. You learn there as well. And remember, if you do start keeping a diary or a journal, keeping your own primary source, take a picture of yourself or a video of yourself with what you've created and go to stpsb.org. And there are three ways listed in which you can submit it so that we can see exactly what you are doing. We are so excited that you're watching these videos. And if you like them, don't forget to keep watching at STPPSTV or on our website at stpsb.org. Remember, keep learning and keep reading. And now a message from my puppy, Burrow.
Burrow says, keep learning and keep reading. Right, Burrow?
Hello, welcome to an SVI special report. The Global Wildlife Center in Folsom is celebrating its 20th anniversary this year, so we've sent our SVI team to find out why over 1 million adults and children have visited this local preserve. Let's go live to Colleen Seeley at the Global Wildlife Center.
Thank you, Matt. Yes, 1 million adults and children have visited the Global Wildlife Center since its opening 2 decades ago. One of the main reasons just may be that they have enjoyed the experience of interacting one-on-one with these exotic animals in their natural habitat, and we had the chance to do just that. It is this type of personal encounter that the staff says makes their job rewarding.
The children who've never seen these animals, getting to see them, their faces light up when they get to feed all the different animals and pet them. So they are learning through interaction and not just looking, you know, through a gate and reading a little posted, you know, information sheet on them.
And there are more than enough opportunities to connect with the inhabitants here.
We have around 35 species and over 4,000 animals that roam free.
The staff has a couple of favorites of their own.
This is Skippy. Skippy was prematurely expelled from his mother's pouch when he was only 3 months old. He loves crackers and the little treats, and he loves the affection that our visitors show towards him, as you can tell.
Well, without a doubt, my favorite animal is our two-humped Bactrian camel, Aladdin. He's one of the older animals on our property. He's been here the entire history of Global Wildlife.
Well, that's a look at why people come to Global Wildlife. Let's go across the compound to Kate Lamori, who brings us the latest on the new residents here.
Thanks, Colleen. A couple weeks ago, Global Wildlife Center adopted 4 new African cicada tortoises. I caught up with the tour guide to give me the lowdown on these new animals on the block.
We have a family of 4 African cicada tortoises, and they were donated to us by a family who was moving up north where the climate was just a little too cold for them. And these guys can live to be 70 to 100 years old. They can weigh up to 60 to 70 pounds. And as you can see, they're very active. Unlike most turtles who I've encountered have been very lethargic, these guys love to crawl around.
These tortoises, along with the rest of the animals here, are taken care of by a nonprofit organization.
So everything that you guys spend out here when you come out and purchase your tickets is considered a donation. So it goes back into the organization to help care for the animals.
While protecting these animals is a worthy cause, there is so much more we gain from this experience.
It's just a unique place. I mean, you come in with a smile and you leave with a smile. You can be 3 years old or 93 and come out here and still have just a fabulous time. And there's no other place like it.
That's it from the Global Wildlife Center with Caitlin Morey, and I'm Colleen Seeley, your SVI team. Back to you, Matt.
Thanks, Caitlin and Colleen. I'm Matt Condon, and that has been an SVI special report.
sunset in July. Rockers by my side, stars flying by. Piling up, done, done, I'm watching you dancing and having the time of your life. And it's here to me.
Hey guys, Miss Sam here.
Whoa! Where'd that come from?
What is this? Oh my goodness.
It's
a message. Let's read it.
Look at it.
What? That doesn't make any sense. I bet whoever wrote this forgot to do the writing rules. We're gonna have to figure this out. We're gonna have to add the writing rules in by rewriting the message. Let's do it. All right, guys. We've got our secret letter here, all ready to go. Got my pen, got my board. Let's rewrite this letter. First thing we need to do is look at our sentence. Take a look at that first letter.
Okay, what do I need to do with that first letter? I know there's something. Does it need to be lowercase or capital?
Yes, it needs to be a capital letter. So we're gonna do a capital L.
Oh, I'm so excited.
L. The next couple of letters of the word should be lowercase.
O-O-K.
I think we just did it. I think we just spelled the word. What word is L-O-O-K? Look! Look, look, look. What is it saying? Look, look what? Look where? All right, we have our next word. I think they forgot to do something to show that we moved on to the next word. What do we need to show that we're starting a new word? Yeah, a space. I'm gonna use my two finger space. O U T S I D Outside. Look outside where? We've got more words. Another space. I O U R. Look outside your. Look outside your what? But I ran out of room. You think I should try to write really small? No? Of course, I should move down to the next line. You guys are so smart. All right, I have a capital letter, but we're still working on the same sentence, so it's gonna be a lowercase. O, O, R. That's all the letters. That's all the words. We just need to do one more thing to finish our sentence. What is it? What do we need to add at the end to show our sentence is complete? Yes, a punctuation mark. In this case, a period. Now, let's read it together. Look outside your door.
Look outside your door?
Well, let's go check. I wonder what it could be. It could be anything. Oh my gosh.
Boo.
My little sister Chloe, how long have you been waiting there?
I've been here a while.
Well, I'm sorry, we got your message, but we couldn't read your writing. You forgot all the writing rules. You didn't capitalize your sentence at the beginning, you forgot all your spaces between words, and you didn't even put a punctuation mark at the end. So it took us longer because we had to go fix the letter by adding all those writing rules in.
Well, I was in a hurry.
Well, that's why we couldn't read it. And you know I'm gonna have to get you back for scaring me.
Wait, wait, no.
Siblings, am I right? Well, anyway, thanks guys so much for helping me figure out what Chloe's message said. And you know, you can write your own secret messages at home too. You can write them as long as you remember the writing rules. Don't forget to start with a capital letter,
Put spaces between your word and add a punctuation mark at the end. That way, whoever you write your secret letter to can read it. Then you can go hide it on their bed or on the couch for them to find and read. As for me, I'm gonna write my secret letter and I think I'm gonna put it in Chloe's shoe for her to find later. Well, have fun guys and see you later.
Hello, my name is Paula Vickers and I'm a St. Tammany Parish Public School music teacher for grades 4, 5, and 6. I'm so glad you could join me today in this lesson. We are going to experience music in nature. You really don't have to have a lot of supplies. I've gathered a couple of sticks to help me during this lesson. While you are outside gathering your sticks, or rocks, or whatever you choose, listen. Listen to the wind blow. If you live near the water, listen to the waves crash. Whatever you're around, listen to it in nature. Listen to the birds chirp. Quite often we miss out by just not listening, even in music. Before we get into making our music with our sticks or rocks, I just want to mention a couple of musicians or composers who have used nature in their music. One that should be very familiar to all of us is Louis Armstrong. Of course, he is from New Orleans, and he's famous for singing the song, What a Wonderful World. Just a couple of the lyrics in there. I see trees of green, red roses too. The next verse begins, I see skies of blue and clouds of white. Look at all the color in nature. Then there was another composer named Claude Debussy or Debussy. It's acceptable to pronounce it both ways. He is what we call an impressionistic composer. And he quite often composed music to paint a picture. In fact, if you look him up and study him, he wanted to be an artist. He's a music artist and a composer. But one song that he composed for vocal music is called Nuit d'Étoiles, and it means starry night. Go outside and look at the stars some night and think about what it would sound like if you put it to music. He also has another piece for symphony called Le Mur. It's the sea. And imagine the waves crashing when you hear that. Well, today I want to teach you a song. It's called I Love the Mountains. And the way I'm going to do that is I'm going to use the echo method. So I will sing a line and then you will sing it back with me. I will sing it with you the second time. So each line is going to be sung twice. I will sing it once and then I want you to join me on the second line, second time when we sing it. And then we will put the song together. I have the lyrics that I will hold up to display for you. I love the mountains. Sing it with me. I love the mountains. I love the rolling hills. I love the rolling hills. I love the flowers. I love the flowers. I love the daffodils. I love the daffodils. I love the fireside. I love the fireside. When all the lights are low, when all the lights are low. And that's the first part of the song. When we get to the second part, it's more nonsense words. And we will talk about that in just a couple of minutes. But let's sing this campfire song, I Love the Mountains. Sing it with me. I love the mountains. I love the rolling hills. I love the flowers. I love the daffodils. I love the fireside when all the lights are low. And you can tell it doesn't sound like it ends. So we're going to put the ending in just a minute. But say this with me. Boom diada. Boom diada. And we're going to sing that a bunch of times. Boom diada, 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 boom. I like to end it with a boom at the end. It's not really written that way, but I think it makes it kind of sound more finalized. So let's sing the entire song together. I love the mountains. I love the rolling hills. I love the flowers. I love the daffodils. I love the fireside when all the lights are low. Boom de ada, 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 boom. Now, what's really fun is if you sing that song through one time, and if you've got somebody there at your house that can join in, they could keep singing. Boom de ada, 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 boom, while you were singing the words, and it makes it pretty cool and interesting. Now, I decided to also go about changing the lyrics. We can change the lyrics. We call that composing when we change something about a song or doing a different arrangement. And I decided, let's think about Louisiana. What could we do and make it sound like a Louisiana song? Or maybe you want to talk about Louisiana food or something else. But since this is nature, I thought, what do I see in Louisiana? I haven't always lived here. So when you move somewhere to a different place, a different town, a different state, you see things differently. So some of the things that I noticed when I first moved to Louisiana about 20 years ago was the bayous, the big oak trees, the Spanish moss growing on the oak trees, the swamps and the lakes. And then the one thing I really love is the sunset glowing upon the lake. So I've taken those words and replaced some of the words that I taught you a few minutes ago. See if you can sing it with me. I love the bayous. I love the big oak trees. I love the Spanish moss. I love the swamps and lake. I love the sunsets glowing upon the lake. Boom de ada, 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 boom. Now, if you get really good at singing the song, you could do the boom de ada on something you found in nature. I have found two sticks in my yard under some trees. Boom de ada, 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 boom de ada. Now I'm going to sing the original lyrics because I know those better than the ones I just wrote, and I'm going to put my sticks with it. I love the mountains. I love the rolling hills. I love the flowers. I love the daffodils. I love the fireside when all the lights are low. Boom de ada, 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 boom. And you can make this anything you want. Have fun with it. Have fun creating new music during this time. Before we leave, let's sing the one about Louisiana one more time. I love the bayous. I love the big oak trees. I love the Spanish moss. I love the swamps and lakes. I love the sunsets glowing upon the lake. Boom de ada, 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 boom. Thank you so much for singing with me today. Thank you for watching as we have learned about music in nature. You did a great job. Remember to keep watching other videos like this one so we can all keep learning together. You can watch daily lessons on STPPS TV or on our website at stpsb.org. See you again soon.
Hi, I'm Brian Donnelly with St. Tammany Parish, and today we're going to work on folding socks for our lesson. I'm just kidding. I'm going to teach you guys a game that only requires two pieces of equipment. One, a pair of socks, and two, a basket. I've got this basket here. They say it's for something called laundry. I'm not sure what that is. And I've got some socks. So let's get started. The first thing I'm going to do is show you how to turn your pair of socks into a ball. Take the two ends where they open up, put those against each other, and then just fold the socks into each other. If you're having trouble, ask someone for help. Now, for our game, it would be best if you can make your socks fold into a shape as round as possible. Also, longer socks will probably work better because it makes the ball a little bit thicker and a little heavier. Now, we're ready to start. The object of the game is pretty simple. Shoot the ball into the goal. The first step is you need to decide, where can I put my basket? Make sure you ask an adult before you put it someplace that they will not be happy with. Right now, I've chosen someplace pretty easy. I put it against my sofa so that I have the cushions as a backboard. And we're just gonna see how many we can make in a row. It's three. See if I get five. Four and five. So that was great. Five out of five. 100%. Maybe I need a little more challenge. This time, to add to the challenge, I've moved the basket from off of the sofa, where it had the cushion behind it, to standing by itself on the ottoman. So now I have no backboard. Let's see if that changes things. Uh-oh, missed the first. Oh, two out of five, 40%. Much more difficult. Now, I'm trying it in my hallway for some long range shots. You might find while you're playing that you need to go ahead and reform the shape of your sock ball. So go ahead and do that before you take your shots. See how I do from long range. Oh, much worse. Only one out of five. 20%. Now I've moved my basket next to the wall so I can practice some bank shots. Make sure you ask an adult, again, where is a good place for them to put the basket so they don't get angry with you. Oh, four out of five, 80%. Getting better. One thing you can do once you get the hang of this is set up a course that's just like the NBA three-point shooting contest that happens at All-Star Weekend. That's what I've done here. I've got a set of socks set up in the corner. I have a set on top of my couch and a set over by my ottoman. Each rack or set has four sock balls. The fifth sock ball is going to be a bonus sock ball. If you have any special socks that you really like, you can make that the bonus ball. I've got a mosquito sock will be a bonus ball. That'll count for 2 points if I make it. My Groot sock will be a bonus ball. That'll count for 2 points. And my beignets and hot cocoa will be a 2-point bonus ball. I'm going to set my watch for 30 seconds, and I'm going to have 30 seconds to make as many as I can. All right, you ready? Let's go! Bonus ball. Last one. And time. You can also try some trick shots. For example, do a push-up, shoot it in. Do a curl up, shoot it in. Doing your schoolwork online, shoot it in. Dust your cabinets and then shoot it in. Maybe backwards. can you make one while wearing a suit and a bow tie? Maybe you don't have to try that one. If you have someone else at your house that you can play with, another game you can play is horse, or its shorter variation, pig. In horse, or pig, the rules are pretty simple. The first person to shoot is said to be in control. That means they get to pick what type of shot and where they shoot it from. If they make it, their opponent has to shoot the exact same shot and make it. If their opponent misses, then they get a letter. So if you were playing horse, the first time they missed, they would get an H. If you were playing pig, it would be a P. If your opponent makes the shot, you continue playing. If the person in control misses their shot, then the second player takes control. Let's see if my opponent is ready. You ready back there? All right. From the chair, sitting down, off the wall. Try to be best, cause you're only a man, and a man's got to learn to take it. Try to believe. In the chair, sitting, off the wall. History repeats itself, try and you succeed. From the chair, sitting down, left-handed, off the wall. In the chair, sitting, left hand, off the wall. Did not hit the wall. Feet up, on the chair. Feet up, on the chair. Kneeling behind the chair, push up. Backward. Backward, not looking. On a knee, behind the sofa, off the wall. Kneeling behind the sofa, off the wall. Standing by the fireplace, push up. By the fireplace, hook shot. Standing by the ottoman, behind the back shot. By the fireplace, underhand scoop shot. Standing by the fireplace, underhand scoop shot. Thanks for watching. I hope you have fun playing this game, and remember, you can continue to watch lessons like this so we can all learn together on the St. Tammany Parish YouTube channel or on the St. Tammany Parish television channel. Until then, bye-bye!
Hey boys and girls, it's Mr. Hebert, St. Tammany Parish Public School Health and Physical Education teacher. This lesson today, I'd like to talk to you about bilateral movements. Bilateral movements, what does that mean? Bilateral movements mean you're doing one thing with one side and another thing with another side of your body, okay? Try this, everybody stand up. Bilateral movements, I want you to rub your belly, pat your head. Try it, see if you can do it. Good. Rubbing your belly and patting your head. And switch. Nice. Now, anybody can do this. Just takes practice. Mr. Avery has been doing this a long time. That's probably why I don't have any hair. Just kidding. Can you think of any other bilateral movements? Think about it. Anything? You probably did it today. You know, bilateral movements. Walking is a bilateral movement. Walking is a bilateral movement. This is stepping and driving. This is recovering, okay? Walking is a bilateral movement. running, jogging, bilateral movements, okay? Swimming is a bilateral movement. Freestyle and backstroke, one of my favorite things to do. Swimming, right here, this is recovery. One side's doing one thing, the other side's doing another thing. Backstroke, catching to get ready to pull, and recovery here, okay? Bilateral movements, one side's doing one thing, the other side's doing another thing, okay? Anything else you can think about? Think about it. One side. Musical instruments. Most musical instruments are bilateral, okay? Violin, you're bowing with one hand, holding the strings in the other. Drumming, you might be doing eighth notes with this hand, quarter notes with this hand, okay? Piano, treble over here, bass over here. Most musical instruments are bilateral. One thing I want to talk to you about today, though, is juggling. Juggling's a bilateral movement. Tossing with one hand, catching with another. Same catching hand is going to be tossing, catching with that tossing hand. Juggling, okay? Go get your bag here, okay? Grocery, plastic grocery bag. Going to start off with one. And when you throw it, you're going to cross your body. I'm throwing with this hand, I'm going to catch it with this hand. Throw and catch. Throw and catch. Throw and catch. Throw and catch. Okay. When you throw in the bag, you want to throw it up high and snag it out the air. Don't toss it and let it float down and catch it like this. You want to grab it and snag it out the air. Juggling a bag, throw, catch. Across your body, throw it towards the hand you're catching with. Okay? Very good. Throw, catch. Throw, catch. Practice destiny. Two bags. Get another bag. One in each hand. Now it's going to be throw, throw, catch, catch. Throw, throw, catch, catch. Ready? Throw, throw, catch, catch. Good. Throw, throw, catch, catch. Throw, throw, catch, catch. Throw, throw, catch, catch. Very good. I'm throwing with the right hand. I'm throwing with my left hand. If you had a hard time doing that, go back to one. Throw, catch. Throw, catch. Throw, catch. I see a lot of students doing this. They take their strong hand, the hand that you color with, or write with, and they do this. This day, man, look! They're only throwing with one hand. They're throwing hand off, throwing hand off. You have to throw, throw, catch, catch, throw, throw, catch, catch, throw, throw, catch, catch. That's the pattern I want you to learn. Because if you could do that comfortably, then you could switch to three. Three, you're gonna take one bag with your fingers like this, okay? Hold one like this, then you're gonna pinch the other one. You're gonna get a third of bag, okay? I got three different colors, trying to get colors here, okay? So the one with two, I'm gonna toss the pinching one first, then I'm gonna throw my gray one, then I'm gonna throw this one. Throw, throw, catch, catch. It's gonna be throw and catch, throw and catch, throw and catch. Ready? Throw and catch, throw and catch. Throw them up high, grab them and snag them. Nice, keep them going. Throw and catch, throw and catch, throw and catch, throw and catch. Very good. If you have a hard time with that, remember, go back to two and practice. Throw, throw, catch, catch. Throw, throw, catch, catch. Throw, throw, catch, catch. Not a circle, okay? Throw with your right, throw with your left, catch, catch. If you have a hard time with that, practice with one. Catch, catch, catch. If you do that, three could be easy. Here we go. I'm gonna throw the gray one first, then this one, then the next one. Ready? Throw and catch, throw and catch, throw and catch, throw and catch, throw and catch. Okay? Nice. Keep it going. Snag it out the air, move it around. Very good. Bag. Alright? Easy practice. Now, balls are a different thing. Okay? One ball. Try with that one. You have to toss the same arc. Alright? You can do this, you can juggle. My right hand's throwing the ball the same way my left hand is, okay? That same arc, I have to get it with both hands throwing, okay? I'm not doing this, okay? I'm throwing the same height, the same arc, that's the key, okay? Two, go back to two. throw, throw, catch, catch. 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 Just like the bags. It's not a throw, hand, throw, hand, throw, hand. Circle. It's throw, throw, catch, catch. Throw, throw, catch, catch. Takes practice. Let me see if I can do three. Same way. Throwing here. Holding this. You ready? Catch it. Now, all of this takes a lot of practice. Walking, when you were little, you need to practice walking. Running takes practice. Swimming takes practice. Musical instruments take practice. Okay? If you want to get good at something, you need to practice. If you want to get good at reading, you need to read more. If you want to get good at math, you need to do more math. If you want to get good at juggling, you need to practice juggling. I suggest practice with one. Get used to throwing and catching with both hands. Hope you enjoyed it. Keep practicing. Stay safe, stay healthy. Bye.
Morning, guys. Today we are going to be learning about the stake tree, the bald cypress. Do you see them behind me? Let's take a closer look.
The bald cypresses are distinguishable because of these knobby knees. Do you see them sticking out? The bald cypress trees usually live in these swamp type settings and can live over 100 years old, over 200 years old, up to 600 years. Can you believe it?
The reason this tree is called the bald cypress is because it's deciduous, meaning it loses its leaves in the winter. This wide base of the tree with the folds like a draping curtain, this is called a buttress root, and it holds the tree in place in this water so it doesn't fall down like in a hurricane. These things that are sticking out that look like knees, they're actually part of the root system. Today, I'm going to show you how to make a bald cypress art piece.
I'm going to begin my project by making the trunk of the tree. I didn't have construction paper, but I did find this craft paper, so I think this will work. I'm going to begin by folding my paper in half. Then I'm just going to start cutting. Now I don't want to cut off the part that I folded. I'm going to start cutting from the outside. I'm going to start with the base, the trunk, and go up. And then this might be a good part to put a branch. I'm going to cut out here and go back in. Go up, maybe make another branch. And then just keep going along. You can make as many branches as you want. Okay, so it's going to end up something like this. You're going to do it again with your second piece of paper. Now that you have your two pieces together, you're going to then tape them. I don't like that the backside is white, so I'm just going to color real quickly in brown, just so it's all solid and colored and will look really nice in the end.
Doesn't it calm a fishy poncho tree?
We are now ready to tape our tree trunks together. So we just line up the folds or the creases and just kind of tape along the edges. Okay, so now we have our bald cypress trunk ready. I'm now ready to create the cypress knees or the roots. I'm going to create the roots by cutting little strips of paper. And I'll cut it in half, that's a little long. And then all I have to do is bend it, and it's going to create some roots or knees. I have now made the base of my cypress tree. I have the trunk, oops, and the knees or the roots. Now I'm going to add leaves. You can make the leaves with green construction paper. I happen to have this craft paper. And I think I'm gonna try to use this paper cutter or die cut. But again, you can just use scissors. Let's see how it turns out. So with the paper cutter, I was able to make this design, and I can just put it here, put it on the trunk of the tree, or again, I might just cut and use scissors and make my leaves that way. It's totally up to you. This is your art, your design, no mistakes.
whatever you want to do. It's going to look great in the end. So there, look, I just use scissors and cut, and I can create these leaves that way. If making these kinds of leaves is too difficult for you, another thing that you can do, just like we did the roots or knees of the tree, you can just make little loops and glue it onto the tree. There's all these different ways to make the leaves, however you choose. Another easy way that you can make leaves is just get a small piece of paper and just cut some fringe, little slits like this, and put it on both sides. And maybe fold it so it has some depth. And then you have another kind of leaf. It's totally up to you. I'm going to keep adding on to the tree by adding more leaves. And I cannot wait to see how your cypress tree turns out. See you next time. Bye.